Good evening, good evening, and welcome along to another big show here on NVTV. Coming up on the show this week, we'll be meeting Matthew Forsythe and Matthew McElhinney, who'll be telling us all about the brand new production of A Night in November, which comes to the Lyric Theatre. We'll be finding out about this year's Belfast Photo Festival, and we'll have some live music from The Rua. We're starting things off now, a band from America. They're back with a brand new album called Low Down Ways. They were in Belfast recently, and they came into the studio to record this for us. So, ladies and gentlemen, here are Daddy Long Legs.
Well, I went walking just the other day, and then I started talking about my low-down ways. And then I started singing, oh Lord, and clapping my hands. Then I started stomping all over this land. Then I went shouting, but I couldn't be heard.
Nobody could hear me, not a lonesome word.
Not a lonesome word.
Not a lonesome word. Not a lonesome word. Well, I couldn't be heard.
Right, the Mary Jones play A Night in November celebrates its 25th anniversary this year. I remember it the first time around, so like me, there'll be plenty of people who will be very excited about seeing the new version, which comes to the Lyric Theatre. Matthew Forsythe is playing the main part, and Matthew McElhinney is directing. Guys, welcome. I'm very excited about this because I remember it first time around with Dan Gordon. Mm-hmm. You obviously don't because you're way too young.
I remember Dan when I was that age, but I don't remember going to see the play. No, I would have been about four whenever it was first staged. So yeah, the initial ones, but I did see Dan do it. I kind of grew up watching Dan do it. And you know, then all the other iterations that came after it. So it's been very much a part of my life growing up, this play.
Because it really is a family affair. Your mummy wrote it.
She wrote it, yes.
And your dad directed the original.
He directed the original. The very first ever director, I think, was Pam Brighton. But then, certainly for many years after that, it was my dad who directed it, yeah.
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 So how much influence is Ian having into this one? Is he telling you, you've got to do this, you've got to do that? Or are you saying, Dad, stay out of it totally, it's my gig?
I haven't seen them for the past couple of months. They're away in Greece, so, and they won't even be back for press night, so it's pretty much up to me. So she'll come back and she'll say, I didn't write that. No, we'll see, yeah. No, they have plenty of free rein with it anyway, you know, and... I mean, they trust me because I know the place so well, and then I know that world because it's a world that I came from, and also being a massive Northern Ireland fan, I kind of have a sensitivity of how I want to treat it. So I think that there's a lot of trust there, you know, that it's going to be on message,
yeah,
and it's not going to stray too far off anything, you know.
And obviously, on the 25th anniversary, it's the perfect time to bring this back, isn't it?
Well, yeah. There was always that question, you know, why now? Why now? And I think 25 years is, you know, it's kind of a big anniversary, but I think it's kind of in the context of how far the Northern Irish support has come in the last 25 years, from the days of the Billy Boys in the early 90s to both sets of fans 2 years ago at the Euros going away to France and winning the Grand Vermeer, the Medal of Honor of the City of Paris, which is, I mean, the progress has been phenomenal, and it's a journey that I've charted with them, because I've been the supporter. When I first started going, there were still those elements in Northern Irish support. And when I first started going, there was a real campaign about giving sectarianism the red card, giving it the boot and getting it out of Northern Irish football. And the fans themselves have done that, along with the IFA, have done that, and it's been incredible. So I think looking back on it now is trying to frame it in a way of saying, that was then, this is now, and look at the progress we've made and how far we've come since.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Matt, going to come to you. Is this the dream role for any actor?
It is, and it's actually, I don't think Matthew and Jared McCabe, the producer, know exactly how much this is a dream for me, because this is probably one of the first plays that I ever seen that really grabbed my attention and drove me to become an actor. It was the part I looked at and thought, I'd love to have a crack at that. Never thought I'd ever have the chance. So it is the dream role. It's you know, you're the story, the play, the fact that the audience is on you for the whole time, and you've got over 20 characters to sort of filter through, you know, so you can really flex your acting skills.
There must be a lot of pressure, because a lot of people like myself will remember Dan Gordon doing it way back in the day, so there must be a lot of pressure on you for people who've seen that.
Exactly, there's a lot of pressure from the people who've seen it, and I'm not trying to sort of contend or contest with those. They have their, you know, they don't their way,
yeah.
And I can't think like that. I have my own pressures with it, because it is probably the play, the part that I've always wanted to do.
So were you a big football fan before you came to this?
Yes, huge football fan. I was actually at the match that night, the match in question. Yeah. Our school took us, and I've always been involved in football from a young age, and played, and a huge Northern Ireland fan as well. So again, the pressure is there because of that as well.
And you're also pretty busy at the minute, because you've just come off Keep Telling Me Lies, which is a huge success as well.
Yeah, it was a huge success. Yeah, so it's been a busy start to the year for me, which is quite unusual for me. I always sort of, I'm quiet at the start of the year and then get slowly busier by the end of it. So it's been fantastic.
Now we do have a bit of an exclusive as well, a Father's Day exclusive, don't we?
That's right, yes. So on the 16th is Father's Day, the Sunday the 16th. There's going to be a post-show question and answer session with me and my dad. Ian McElhinney, who, you know, Game of Thrones fame, Derry Girls. So it'll be me and him doing a post-show Father's Day exclusive question and answer session, just about, well, whatever people want to ask us, but I'm sure we'll talk about his experience of directing the play and the mine and, you know, what that's like, you know.
Or these days, do people just want to call him Grandad Joe?
Grandad Joe, yeah. Grandad Joe, he'll be there. He'll be there in character. Yeah.
So Night in November is coming to the Lyric Theatre. When?
12th of June to the 21st. Then on tour down the line. So we're looking forward to it.
Brilliant. You're directing. Matt, you're starring. And we're going to mention Jared McCabe, who's down there in the corner, who's taking all the risks. He's producing this one, isn't he?
So. Making sure we follow the party line.
Well, do you know what, guys? I saw it the first time around with Dan, and I'm really looking forward to coming to see it with you guys as well. So the very best of luck.
Brilliant. Thank you, Robin. Thanks.
Right, time for some more live music, and this time a group are doing very well for themselves in America. They're also on tour throughout the whole of the UK and Ireland with Westlife, and they popped into the studio to record a live session with us earlier on this week. So here are The Rua.
My mind away, take the fear. You changed your touch. I don't feel the warmth inside of you. The secret love, is it better than what I gave to you? Take it away, your poison heart. Can you hear me crying? On the floor I'm lying. You said it's enough, because when I'm with you we light it up. I'm the fire, your gasoline, burn it all over me. You take me away, away from here. Capture my mind away, take the fear. 'Cause I am a fire, I'm gonna light ya, I'm gonna burn it down. I'm getting brighter. Because when I'm with you, we light it up. I'm the fire, your gasoline. You take me away, away from here. Capture my mind. Because when I'm with you, we light it up. I'm the fire, your gasoline, burning all over me. You take me away, away from here. Capture my mind away, take the fear. 'Cause I am a fire, I'm gonna light ya, I'm gonna burn.
So that's a great song. That's called Gasoline from the Ruhr. And the guys join me in this fabulous hotel in downtown Belfast right now. The Ruhr, how are we all?
We're really good, thank you. Thank you for coming down.
So first of all, tell us about the song that we just saw there, Gasoline.
So Gasoline is our second single off this album that we have out. It's currently 28 in the chart. And Jonathan wrote that song, actually, so he probably can tell you more about the actual song and why he wrote it.
Okay, we'll go to Jonathan then. Jonathan, tell us the story behind the song then.
Hello. So the song is about, say, those type of relationships that you're in, you're not sure if they're good or bad for you, but you're going to go with them, and it could go well, or it could end up in flames. You don't know.
And of course, it's very exciting because the album's just been released here as well, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's just been released. So we're really excited about that. So everyone go buy it.
Okay. Of course, the other big exciting news is you're on tour with Westlife here in Belfast at the moment. How's it been going so far?
Yeah, it's been absolutely amazing. I mean, we used to listen to Westlife when we were growing up. So it's been an amazing experience to then be able to come and play and open up for them. And then when we finish and we go and we stand in the rest of the crowd and we're like, yeah, we know all these songs, and you can see everyone else dancing around and absolutely loving it, and it's great.
So what about the whole experience then of playing the SSE Arena here in Belfast? What's the audience has been like?
The audiences have been absolutely incredible. You never know what you're going to get. They're listening to brand new songs, so we've thanked them every single night for listening to our music. But the response has been great. We've had lots of Instagram and Facebook messages from people that have loved our music, so we're really happy that we're connecting with fans here.
Brilliant. Okay. So tell us about the Ruhr then. Obviously, you're all related. You're all family. But what age were you when you decided, yes, this is what we're going to do? We're going to go out there and actually make this a career.
Well, we grew up playing music. So our grand's from Derry, and we'd be over there playing at the Fache every year when we were growing up. We did piano, violin, singing. What else? First speaking in the Fache as well. So we've done it forever and had exams in it and did it at school as well. And did choirs, but then probably about 6 years ago, we're like, okay, let's try now together and play. And so since then, we've been working away at it.
Now, you guys have also done a lot in America, so yeah. I suppose that was kind of the best way to do it, crack America first, wasn't it?
Yeah, our label wanted to bring us out there to kind of crack that American audience, and we spent a long time going around to every single radio station possible. And I think our first single, Fight For What's Right, which we actually do play, that's the only song we play off our old album on our set, but Fight For What's Right, I think, got to 42 in the airplay chart there. And now Gasoline's at 28, and it's 28 in the Billboard chart. So it's been a very long, slow, but extremely enjoyable process. You know, you got to enjoy the process of it. Otherwise, you never going to enjoy it once you get there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Now, apart from Westlife, you've also supported Leanne Rimes, yeah. Goo Goo Dolls, Train. Mm-hmm. That's an impressive list so far, isn't it?
And they're wonderful people too. I remember when we did that, when we supported Train, that was the first time we played an arena, and that was about 4,500 people, which is nothing in comparison to playing the SSC. But and we went to meet Paddy from Train, and he knew who we were because he played our stuff on his show on Sirius XM, which is a radio station. He was like, "The Rua, I play you guys on my show," and we were like, "He knows who we are, yay!" But everyone we've played with has been amazing. Like, we've played with Leanne Rimes about 3 or 4 times, and every time we've seen her, she's just been like, "Hi again, guys!" Like, that. I think we've been so lucky to be able to play with so many people, and just such great musicians. You know, we're very grateful for that.
All right. Okay, we're going to hear another one of your songs now. Tell us a little bit about the story behind this one.
I actually had this idea in my head. It was just a melody. And we still live together. And I was walking down the stairs, and I just kind of started singing it. And I was going... And I was like, "Guys, I got a really catchy melody." And they were like, yeah, we'll get to it. And then Alana, the day after, was singing the melody. And I was like, "See, I told you it was catchy." And then all I ever wanted... probably happened over like a few months, actually. It wasn't a one sit down. But it is just about having that person that is all you ever wanted. And it's not necessarily just about a romantic relationship. It's just those people that make you feel the best you that you can be.
All right. Okay. We'll hear the song now. Guys, thank you so much. And enjoy the rest of the Westlife tour.
3, 4. When your lips are close to mine, I get carried away. Hey. When I'm with you, all I find is losing track of time. Don't go, don't stop, let's get complicated. I'm swept away like a bubble. No SOS, I'm already in trouble. 'Cause you like your daydream, don't wanna break out. Scared of every second, 'cause you're when you look into my eyes, I'm Lucy in the skies. Eyes. When you hold me, all I know is please don't let me go. Don't go, don't stop, let's get complicated. I'm swept away like a bubble. No SOS, I'm already in trouble.
Get carried away. Now, how would you like to abseil down the front of the Europa Hotel in Belfast? We're going to tell you in just a second how you can do that, because Colin Barkley from the Northern Ireland, Children to Lapland and Days to Remember Trust, has joined me in the studio. Colin, how are you, sir?
I'm good, thank you. Nice to be here.
Thank you for joining us. So we'll talk about the charity first. I remember the charity as Children to Lapland Trust. You have been around for quite a while, haven't you?
Yeah, we've just completed 10 years. And it was always a trip to Lapland every December. We started off with a 140-seater plane. We're now, the last number of years, we've been on a 220-seater plane. And hopefully next year we're looking to maybe a 320-seater. And it's a fabulous day for the kids. But, you know, it's a difficult life for them. And so it's for them and for their families. We try and make a difference coming up to Christmas.
And of course, to be able to do this, you need the much needed funds.
Absolutely. And a lot of people think because it's a Christmas style charity that the fundraising is October, November, December, but it's very much a 12-month exercise, and we're fundraising all the time in all sorts of different ways. And people are very, very generous. And especially when we're talking about kids, I mean, our mission is about terminally ill, life-limited and deserving children. That's what we're concentrating on. And regrettably, there are an awful lot of those in Northern Ireland at any given time. So if we could have a 500-seater plane, we could fill it without a problem.
Yeah.
So we need to, the more money we raise, the more kids we can take on these trips, and that's the bottom line.
I've seen the photographs over the years and the smiles on their faces, because it really is taking them to another world.
Yeah, a lot of them have never been out of Northern Ireland. And I remember the first time I went, you know, and I've travelled a wee bit, and suddenly 3 hours after leaving Aldergrove, we land, and an hour later we're in a forest in complete darkness in a sledge led by reindeer. Yeah. You know, and it was pretty special. And to see the faces of the kids, and some of the parents are saying, look, I haven't seen my son or my daughter laugh for 2 years, and look at them today. You know, so it really is. It's a charity that really hits home.
Okay. Now, of course, to make these things happen, you're relying on the public to help you fundraise and bring in some money.
Yeah, and as I said, it's in all sorts of different ways. I mean, for example, there's a lovely couple, Richard and Gemma. We don't know them. They're not particularly supporters of the charity, but they're getting married, and they've said, instead of wedding presents, can you please make a donation to the Children to Lapland Trust? Yeah. Which is really fabulous. So there are lots of things happening at any given time. Michael Dunlop chose us as his charity for the Northwest 200. So he has a new bar restaurant in Port Stewart, and the villa, the doorman and whatever, did a sponsored walk around the Northwest 200 track. All sorts of different ways of doing it.
You're organising an abseil as well down the front of the Europa Hotel.
Yeah.
I've done it twice
well,
before.
Well, that's two more than I've done it.
And it is a good experience as you're going down. The scary bit is when you're standing on the top of the Europa Hotel with your back to Belfast on this little ledge that's going backwards and forwards like that, and the guy says to you...
We're trying to encourage people to take this on.
The guy says to you, just let go, and you've got to let yourself go over the edge. But it's fun. It's amazing when you let yourself go over
I've
the
got
edge.
To the top looking down. I'd never any intention of doing the actual abseil, and I understand exactly what you're saying.
You've got to do it. You've got to do it.
No, I don't think so. My medical insurance wouldn't cover it. But I mean, we've done it. I think this is our fifth time, or maybe we've done it five times, but we're just looking for people who are adrenaline junkies, want to try something different. It's 51 metres, 53 metres, 13 stories. So, you know, it is something that they will remember. We actually had a lady 2 years ago who did it to celebrate her 82nd birthday.
Brilliant.
And this year, for her 84th birthday, she's doing a skydive for us.
Wow.
So there are people out there who definitely are adrenaline junkies. And I think the first one we did, we had 110 people dressed as Santa Claus. So you can imagine if you open your curtains staying in the Europa Hotel and suddenly there's a Santa Claus hanging outside your window. Must have been, what did I drink last night, you know? But no, we're hoping to get, we set ourselves a target of 60, mm-hmm. And we're already at, I think it's 52. But that target can go up. We can get up to 100 people. So if there are people out there who fancy doing it, it's on the 23rd of June. We only ask that they bring in a minimum of £100 sponsorship, £30 of which has to be paid as a deposit, because that's a non-returnable deposit to the organisers. But it's from 12 o'clock on at the Europa, and it's something I think they will remember.
So if they want to sign themselves up, how do they do that?
onto our website, which is niclt.org, and all the details are there. But it's Sunday the 23rd of June.
Great stuff. Well, Colin, thank you for coming in and telling us all about that, and the best of luck for the rest of the year.
Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you. So, time now for our What's On guide, where we take a look and see what's happening throughout Belfast and beyond over the next week or so. And we're starting off at the Grand Opera House, because Samantha Womack stars in a gripping stage adaptation of Paula Hawkins's popular novel The Girl on the Train, which comes to the Grand Opera House from the 11th until the 15th of June. And Rachel Watson longs for a different life. Her only escape is the perfect couple she watches through the train window every day, happy in love, or so it appears. She then finds herself as a witness in a thrilling mystery that will keep you guessing until the final moments. Irish singer-songwriter Kieran Goss and singer Annie Kinsella have just released their debut duo album, Oh the Starlings, and you can catch them live at the Playhouse Derry on the 8th of June and the Lyric Theatre in Belfast on the 9th of June with songs, stories and harmonies that will transport the listener to another world. This is a show not to be missed. Kaz Hawkins returns to the Mac on the 9th of June, where she sold out in 2018 with her hard-hitting show My Life and I. And this time, Kaz is bringing new material, a new stage set, and all this to the Mac's intimate Luminaire Club. So join us for a very special Belfast show before Kaz heads off for a summer in Europe. Staying with the Mac, and you can join the Belfast girls, favourite characters Big Bernie Green, Michelle, Shankle Joe and Ma live. Packed with songs from the Belfast girls' Facebook page, this comedy play will have you dancing in the aisles and laughing all night. And Belfast girls runs at the Mac until the 23rd of June. The Simon and Garfunkel Story returns to Theatre at the Mill in Newton Abbey on the 7th of June. And using huge projection photos and original film footage, this 50th anniversary celebration features a full live band performing all the hits, including Mrs. Robinson, Cecilia, Bridge Over Troubled Water, Homeward Bound, and many more. And finally for now, if you want to catch a movie in cinemas this weekend, the X-Men are back with Dark Phoenix. And Jean Grey begins to develop incredible powers that corrupt and turn her into a Dark Phoenix. And now the X-Men will have to decide if the life of a team member is worth more than all the people living in the world.
Ladies and gentlemen of NASA, this is Charles Xavier. Help is on the way.
We're doing space missions now. Cool.
We get the astronauts, we bring them home. Go.
Heat signature's rising fast.
We gotta get out of here.
Where's Jean?
Where is she?
Jean!
She should be dead.
Did you hear what the kids are calling you? Phoenix.
Hello, Jean. Who are you? The better question is, who are you?
Something's happening to me.
When I lose control, bad things happen. But it feels good.
That power destroyed everything it ever came into contact with. Until you. The X-Men fear you. And what they fear, we seek to destroy.
She'll kill us all.
Girl dies.
She's still our friend.
She's not Jean anymore.
Are you threatening me?
That's right.
That would be a bad idea.
Jean!
Right, the Belfast Photo Festival is back and it runs right through until the 30th of June. Michael Weir joins me in the studio to tell us all about this year's festival. Michael, how are you, sir?
I am very good, thank you very much.
Thank you for coming in. I've got the programme in front of me here. It seems like a pretty big festival this year, lots going on.
Yes, jam-packed. Every year you say, let's try not make it any bigger, let's just keep it at this size. But every year it gets a little bit bigger. You know, bigger and better is always what you're aiming for, but it's the scale that's changed as well. We've actually started to kind of get to the point where we've taken over every public space in the city, so we're actually wrapping buildings now as well.
Brilliant, excellent. Now, the theme I see this year is truth and lies.
That's
Tell
right,
us the story behind this.
Well, truth and lies, I think it kind of speaks for itself in a lot of ways. Last year, or certainly over the past 2 years, fake news has been talked about so much. And I got together with all the galleries and all our curators internationally last year and said to them, well, what do you think people care about? What is important for us to be talking about at the minute? And it's the role of photography in fake news. You know, people talk about fake news a lot and it's all about, the spoken word or the written word, but photography has played such a huge role in spreading fake news and misconstruing the truth, whether it be constructed or just being misrepresented. So we kind of wanted to really look at that, but not necessarily just show you, oh, this is what's been in the news, this is true and this is false. We wanted to, being a visual arts festival, really look at how visual artists have kind of helped to make that very black and white and helped to make it very digestible, how easy it is to manipulate it and construct it to tell the truth or to tell lies.
Exactly, okay. Tell us about some of the highlights of this year's festival then.
The highlights, we've got an exhibition in the Golden Thread Gallery called Do Governments Lie? We're not answering the question, but we're asking the question. We all can come up with our own answers. And within that, we have two really interesting works. We have an artist, Philip Chancel from Belgium, who had been commissioned photograph in North Korea, and obviously portray a very certain version of North Korea. But what he saw there was poverty. What he saw was people living in and working in difficult conditions. So when he was between commissioned shots, he was sneaking shots. He's banned from North Korea now, but he was sneaking shots to really kind of get a true reflection of how people really felt, because what he noticed was that when he was taking pictures of people, what he called Kim happiness, was that people just got ecstatically happy.
Yes.
All the time. But we all smile for a portrait, but there it seemed to be taken to the extremes. So he was trying to really capture how people felt between these kind of commissioned shots. And then as part of that show as well, we've got a piece by a famous creator and artist, Eric Kessels from the Netherlands, and it's called Jump Trump. And it coincides with Trump's visit to Ireland and the UK. And basically it's an opportunity to get up close and personal. You know, I'm probably never going to meet the president. You might meet the president, I don't know. But
I have no plans to.
Not in the diary.
But
it's an opportunity to, whether you love him, you know, whether you loathe him, to get Some people love him. Some people do love him, yeah. To get up close and personal. And you get to jump from a height of about 2 meters onto a giant stump mat of his face, which is about 5 meters by 8 meters, and express yourself however you wish. And it's free, you can jump as many times as you like, so if you're having a stressful day, you know, feel free to come and jump on Trump.
That is brilliant.
Yeah.
I can't wait to see that.
It's a bit of fun.
That sounds so good. So what else have we got to look forward to then?
We've got H+, which a lot of people, H+, what does that mean? It's almost like human plus. Mm-hmm. So I suppose you could say cyborgs. It's the movement is called transhumanism, and it's here to stay. Essentially, cyborgs are already here. You know, we already walk around with our phones in our pockets. We now have straps, so our phones are attached to our arms. A lot of us are wearing Fitbits now. The next step is really for technology to be integrated into your body, and it's this whole show called H+. By an artist called Matthew Gafso, is just showing how this is already happening. So he's got, for example, there's one guy called Brian, who's actually from here, lives in South Africa now, but he's one of the world's first cyborgs, and he has an antenna built into the back of his brain here, and it comes out to the front of his head to about here, and he uses it to see. The guy's actually blind, but he uses this antenna to see. And that's just one example of in this documentary project where the artist has just covered around the world all these different versions of cyborg that have kind of come into play now to show people that cyborgs are here. We're already integrating technology into our bodies, and this is the future, you know, and it's to get us to start thinking about it, to start talking about it. And essentially, I think it's inevitable, but it's just opening people's eyes.
All right, so from cyborgs to giants, land of the giants.
Land of the giants. This piece actually is already in place. This was installed yesterday in Castle Place, and it's kind of a play. It's about 5 stories high, the picture. It's a giant building wrap. And really, we kind of thought, you know, Belfast, Northern Ireland, land of giants. We have Finn McCool, we have Samson, we have Goliath. And at the scale that this is at, it actually looks like a giant pulling apart the buildings in the city. And we kind of wanted it to be a bit of a Belfast, let's stop looking towards the past and let's start looking towards the future. And in the wake of the Primark fire, you know, we see a lot of old pictures around the city of Belfast. And this is kind of a more, let's look to the future. You know, Belfast, there's so much promise. And this picture is kind of to reflect that, but in the style of embracing giants.
Now, there's a site on social media that I love looking at called Abandoned NI that goes into all these abandoned buildings. And I see they get a mention here as well.
They do, yes. In East Belfast, there's going to be a tour of an abandoned building that's been taken over by artists. And yeah, it's a great opportunity to get into buildings. I'm sure there's going to probably be some ghost stories in there.
Of course,
everyone loves a ghost story of an abandoned building. So yeah, I'm sure that'll be in there as well.
And of course, you always support new talent, don't you? Emerging talent.
Absolutely, that's so important to us. We have exhibition Post Truth, which is launching, from students from the University of Ulster. We incorporate the graduation show of the University of Ulster into the festival and bring people from all over the world to come to that show. We've got representatives from Vice Media, ID, New York Times, Aperture New York. We bring them all to the University of Ulster to say, take a look at the talent coming out of this city. And one of the most noteworthy things is our open submission. We had 35,000 entries from around the world, which far surpasses any photography festival in the rest of the UK, in Ireland, or certainly those I'm aware of in Europe. And it shows that people want the exhibit in Belfast. Belfast Photo Festival does have a massive international reputation. And we're going to be showcasing the best of that work in St. Anne's Square.
Brilliant. Okay. And finally, you've got some walking tours, bus tours, photography tours walking going on.
Yeah. Well, it's an interactive festival. You know, it isn't just Jump Trump. we want people to tell their own stories, have the opportunity to get around the city, appreciate the city, create their own stories, and learn, you know, how to use their cameras a little bit better.
So for the next few weeks, you'll see plenty of people on the streets. There'll be cameras flashing all
absolutely.
Over Belfast.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's the idea. You won't miss us.
Brilliant stuff. Well, it sounds like a great festival. It runs right through until the 30th of June. So, Michael, the very best of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. So that's all we have time for on The Big Show this week. A big thank you to all my guests. We'll be back next week with lots more great guests, including singing songwriting legend Steve Forbert. So we'll see you next week. And to play us out one more time, here are Daddy Long Legs. See you next week.
1, 2, 3, 4. Outside of the winner's circle. 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 Down on my luck, trying to make a buck. The time has come to play my hand. Two's too many and one ain't enough. I'm watching from the witness stand. The cards all stacked, the bottom of the pack. The ace is up my sleeve. I'm lost in the shuffle, another bad hustle. All I can do is grin. Outside of the winner's circle, ain't no place to be. Outside of the winner's circle, what's gonna become of me? There ain't nowhere to turn, Lord, I guess I never learned. See that writing on the wall. And now there's no tomorrow, got me swimming in the sorrow. Cause this time I bet it all. Well, if it don't pan out, gonna scream and shout, repute my name once more. Cause I've been duped and now I've been scorned. All I can do is mourn. Outside of the winner's circle, gentlemen, place your bet. Outside of the winner's circle, this race ain't over yet. Woo!
had a checkered past, thought I'd come out on top. My pony let me down, and I hit it out of town on a Greyhound bus nonstop. She came in last, had a checkered past, now I'm on a roll ride. My pony let me down, Lord, I'm headed out of town. Looks like my luck ran out. Outside.